All right, thanks everyone for coming to another C2C Care webinar. We're going to give it just a few minutes for the room to populate. But as always, this is a timely bunch. So everyone's coming on time, which is always appreciated. Okay. So I'm going to start with just a couple of really quick slides, and then we're going to get into today's program. You are here today for another C2C Care webinar. This one's called Where to Find Aid and How to Get Training for Disasters. My name is Robin Bauer-Kilgo, and I am the C2C Care Coordinator, and I'm located just outside of Washington, D.C. in Silver Spring, Maryland. Again, after just a couple of these few quick slides, we are going to go ahead and get today's program started. That's me again. If you need to reach out to me for any reason for the program, feel free to email me at c2cc@culturalheritage.org. As always, this is our home on the web, connectingtocollections.org. On that website, if you're new with us, you will find the entire archives of Connecting to Collections Care. The program is over 10 years old, so there's quite an archive of webinars on there. You'll also see links to our curated resources, a link to our moderated community, which is a great place to ask questions, and anything else you might think might be useful for the actual program itself. And we have two homes on social media. We are on Facebook and Twitter, so you can follow us there for any kind of announcements for upcoming program or anything else you might be interested in our program. There are two ways to communicate with our presenter today. We have access to a chat box, which is somewhere where you can say hello and let people know either where you're located or anything else, or even talk about the weather today. I know we were just chatting in the green room beforehand that it's gotten a bit colder again in some of our locations, which is very interesting. So feel free to share that if you'd like to. Oh, and let me go back real quick. The other way that you can actually communicate to our panelists is through the Q&A box. Now we will have a dedicated Q&A section at the end of this program. We do encourage you at any point to put a question in the Q&A box. It's a great way to communicate with us. Again, we direct those questions to the Q&A box because it is slightly easier to track them within that box. You also note that we've enabled closed captioning for this program. So if you hit the CC button, you'll actually be able to access closed captioning. And we are recording today's program. So if you happen to miss it or dip out early, you'll be able to see a recording in a few days on our C2C Care website. We do have, actually today, looks like we're finalizing out our entire slate of summer programming, which I'm pretty excited about. But as of right now, we have one officially announced on our website that you can register for. On June 7th from 1 to 2 p.m., we'll be talking to our colleagues over at CCAHA about their Collections Management Policy Toolkit, which is a great way for institutions to kind of work on their collections management policy, which is one of those core documents within the collection. They have a great new tool that they can actually use to talk about it. So I would encourage you to sign up for that webinar if you're going to be working on it. As for other future things, keep an eye on our website and those social media feeds, and you'll be finding out about our slate of summer programming very soon. So we have a jam-packed program today, all circled around May Day and emergency programming and basically how to find training for emergency disasters, where to get resources, all that fun stuff. We have four presenters scheduled for today. We have Lori Foley from HENTIF, who is going to be here presenting first. We also have Elena Gregg, who's my colleague over at FAIC, who handles emergency programming. We have Stacy Bowe, who's the training program manager at Smithsonian Cultural Resource Initiative, and Adam Rush, who's a senior consulting engineer for an architectural firm located here in DC. So we're excited to talk about today's program. I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing my screen briefly. And we are going to ask Lori to go ahead and get started with her section of the program. So Lori, feel free to take over and start sharing your screen whenever you are ready.
Thank you, Robin. Okay, you can see that, correct? Not yet. Now you can, yes?
It looks perfect. You can go for it.
All right, so thank you, Robin, and good day or good evening to everyone who is tuning in. I'm going to be referring to the Heritage Emergency National Task Force by its acronym, pronounced HENTEF, because it's quite a mouthful. As HENTEF coordinator, I work in that unique space where cultural heritage and emergency management intersect at the federal level. HENTEF's mission is based on connecting the cultural community with the emergency management community, and this concept is going to be resonating throughout today's presentations. When I speak to emergency managers, I often find that I have to explain that the arts and culture sector comprises more than just museums. It spans so much more than even what's noted here. I constantly remind emergency managers, including those at the Federal Emergency Management Agency, or FEMA, where I work, that when disaster strikes a community, recovery of these very institutions is vital for the economic, social, artistic, religious, and civic life of that community. As you well know, if these institutions, if your institutions, don't recover, the community never fully recovers. HENTEP is co-sponsored by FEMA's Office of Environmental Planning and Historic Preservation and the Smithsonian Cultural Rescue Initiative. And Stacy is here to talk about SCRI and HENTEP as well. Today, we advocate for the protection of cultural heritage and the arts, and we do that every single day. I want to first give you a 30,000 foot view on disasters, which are increasing in frequency as well as severity. In 2022, the US experienced 18 separate weather and climate disasters that cost at least $1 billion. As you can see, the events range from drought and heat waves in the West, to severe weather in central and north central US, to tornadoes in the Southeast, and hurricanes in Florida, Fiona, Ian, and Nicole. Damages from the 2022 disasters totaled $165.1 billion, and that's billion with a B. This is how FEMA shares disaster-specific information with the public. When a disaster is declared, that means that the president has approved a federal disaster aid request made by a state or territory to support its efforts to respond and recover. The highlighted areas indicate which counties have been approved for this assistance. As you know, California has been pummeled by severe weather and successive atmospheric storms. This is the latest California declaration made on April 3rd. Memorize those highlighted counties because a disaster was declared for these counties in January of this year when the first of 14 atmospheric rivers started rolling over the state. Recovery efforts of California are going to stretch into years. The two of us at FEMA, who work full-time at FEMA, who administer HENTEP, couldn't possibly address all the disasters that have been occurring. So HENTEP amplifies its efforts through its members. Among its 19 federal members are culture-related agencies, such as the Library of Congress, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and the National Endowment for the Arts, among many others. I hope you're a member of at least one of HENTEP's 43 national service organizations, such as AAM or ALA, and I'll explain why in a moment. HENTEP leverages this network to help FEMA and our federal partners connect with and assist cultural institutions and arts organizations at the local level. That's you. FEMA looks at emergency management as a continuum rather than the circular construct you're probably more familiar with. HENTEP's work spans the full emergency management continuum from preparedness through recovery. FEMA's ready.gov provides preparedness guidance for a range of hazards, but I have to hasten to add that it's guidance for individuals, not institutions. There's no need to reinvent the wheel when it comes to identifying the hazards that can affect your organization. It's the job of your local emergency manager to know what those hazards are. Use this research into hazards as an opportunity to connect with your local emergency manager. So what exactly does HENTEP do? Following a major disaster declaration, HENTEP wants to know which institutions have been affected, which ones have not, and the extent and severity of the damage. Knowing these answers helps us support the federal response. But these questions cannot be answered at the federal level. They have to come from the local level. And who's at the local level? You. After an event such as a flood or a wildfire, I ask these entities to share information with and ask for reports of damage from you as the boots on the ground. But you won't receive critical information or assistance if you're not connected to at least one of these entities. The first URL that's posted here links to the preparedness tips that you see on the slide, which I welcome you to share at any time. Monitor disaster information via your state emergency management agency, and this link provides you a list of those agencies. If you live or work in a hurricane-prone area, or even if you're simply interested in a major disaster, the National Hurricane Center is an indispensable resource for up-to-date information. I encourage you to get involved with your state and or regional associations for many reasons, but for my purpose, it's because they serve as two-way conduits of vital disaster information. Regional conservation and preservation centers, such as the Conservation Center for Art and Historic Artifacts, offer extensive disaster resources. Join an Alliance for Response Network. You'll hear more about AFR from Elena Gregg. And finally, become acquainted with the federal public assistance process by starting with the overview noted here. Among HNTEP's many recovery actions, we draw on the diverse expertise of our members to deliver technical assistance, guidance, and resources. In the left photo, following Hurricane Maria, HNTEP worked to bring training in mold removal and health and safety to Puerto Rico's cultural stewards. On the right is a theater in Mayfield, Kentucky, with the wall behind the stage completely missing after destructive tornadoes struck Western Kentucky in December 2021. HNTEP has been working with federal partners and the Kentucky Arts Council to bring support to artists and arts and culture organizations following this event. And for the July 2022 flooding that occurred in Eastern Kentucky, which you'll also hear about later. Public Assistance, or PA, is the FEMA grant program that provides federal funding to state and local governments and private nonprofit organizations following a presidential disaster declaration. The PA process is hard to understand and even harder to navigate. When your organization is hit by a disaster, do you know what to do in terms of requesting funds to help you recover? The reference for federal recovery is FEMA's Public Assistance Program and Policy Guide, which is fondly referred to in the federal government, or at least at FEMA, as Papa G. The current edition is 277 pages long, so I strongly encourage you to start now to become familiar with Papa G before disaster befalls your organization. This field guide in English and Spanish was published last year by N. Caper, a HNTEP member, the National Coalition for Arts Preparedness and Emergency Response. It was created with a lot of input from many federal agencies to help demystify federal disaster relief for the arts and culture sector. It helps artists and arts organizations see what's available, understand clearly what isn't available, and decide if pursuing federal aid, and not just FEMA's public assistance, whether that's a good use of your time. But don't be misled by the title. It also applies to cultural institutions. Do check out HNTEP's robust resources. And that's a quick overview of assistance available through FEMA. I'm Lori Foley of the Heritage Emergency National Task Force. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. That was great. We were really hoping with that first segment to really show all of you institutions who are listening kind of where you might find some immediate resources in times of emergencies. So now we're going to go ahead and transition into some more trained volunteers and volunteer in the training aspect of emergencies and emergency response. Our next two presenters up are going to be Elena Gregg and Adam Rush. They are more than welcome to take over whenever they are ready. Oh, and I should also add that FAIC are doing their annual May Day giveaway, which is always very exciting for them. I'm going to put a link in the chat right now. If you enter in for a raffle, you will get, I believe, free registration to a C2C care course, Elena, and some other maybe fun prizes. So feel free to take over whenever you're ready.
All right. I think I'm opening this up and then we'll share with the hand it off to Elena afterwards. Hi, everyone. My name is Adam Rush. I'm a structural engineer with Simpson, Gumperts, and Hager. That's my day job. And then I'm also a volunteer task lead with APT Dry. Now, you may ask, what is APT Dry? And that really is the purpose of this presentation. All right, let me get into the correct thing. There we go. So first, let's introduce the parent organization, APT. APT International. APT is a multidisciplinary member organization that promotes technology and the best technology for preserving our built environment. We've really created a collaborative environment for sharing and gathering information and working on really complex and challenging subjects to repair and keep existing buildings functioning. Now, APT's mission, let me just have to move something off screen here so I can read it. APT's mission, just to help cement it, is to advance appropriate traditional and new technologies to care for, protect, and promote the longevity of the built environment and to cultivate the exchange of knowledge throughout the international community. The Disaster Response Initiative, or DRY, was established in 2017, so we're still a pretty young task organization under APT, and our mission is to leverage the preservation expertise of the parent organization to improve heritage structures' performance impacted by disasters. Now, that performance can be during an event to reduce the damage to the structure, and then after an event to improve the recovery time. And this is really the definition of resilience. Now, we are focusing on three avenues to improve our outreach, and that is assist after events, to deploy to sites after a disaster, to help with triage, looking at establishing priorities for building owners of what to repair and where to focus their resources. We also look at educating organizations through webinars and workshops, just like this. And a big part of what we're doing is collaborating with other like-minded partner organizations like the NHR and HENTEF and many other similar ones. Now, where does the Disaster Response Initiative come in, or DRY? We're not going to be coming in as first responders with search and rescue, similar to, So if you see this spray paint that I just highlighted, that is marking for search and rescue teams to let folks know that they've gone in and looked in the building. We're not part of that wave. We're really coming in after the events happened, after some of the dust has settled, and looking at how do we help people protect their structures. Now, APT DRY is a volunteer organization, and our leaders are all professionals throughout the community. I'm a structural engineer. Rachel is a envelope consultant, so looking at the performance of the envelope of the building. Will is another structural engineer in Canada, so we are growing gradually, admittedly, our reach internationally. And Trish is a program director at Drayton Hall, so she provides a great resource to help folks navigate, you know, how do you get RFPs out? How do you actually find technical professionals to work on your buildings? So for more information, go to our website, apt.org, And also, if you're in the Seattle area or interested in coming out to Seattle, we are putting on a disaster workshop as part of the annual conference for APT. So that is in October. And now I think it'll be Elena's turn.
Thank you, Adam. Let me share my screen here. Okay, I think I have the display correct this time. Cool. All right. Hi, everybody. As Robin said earlier, I'm Elena Gregg. I'm the Emergency Programs Manager for the Foundation for Advancement in Conservation, or FAIC. And today, throughout the course of today, I'm going to talk about both the National Heritage Responders and Alliance for Response. But for this portion of today, I'm going to talk about NHR. So the National Heritage Responders, there we go, are one of our key emergency programs. They're a volunteer corps that is comprised of about 120 active volunteers. They're intentionally located all over the country. And we also onboard people according to their specialty. So we have conservation professionals, archivists, collection managers, curators. We have several emergency managers, and allied professionals as well. And they are involved with emergencies kind of in three different capacities. So we have an emergency hotline, which is at the bottom of the screen, but the number is 202-661-8068. That is staffed by our volunteers 24/7. So if you have a collections emergency and want some initial advice, you can call that number. Whoever's monitoring the hotline, if the question is outside of their expertise, then they will, you know, phone the rest of the volunteer corps and somebody will be able to get back to you. Typically, this process takes about 24 hours total, to get a response to whatever question you're going to ask. And then we recently started a public helpline email about 2 years ago, NHR public helpline at culturalheritage.org. This is a way to send in any questions about personal items that you're concerned about. Our same volunteer corps will get back to you via email. They also have a virtual assessment and deployment model that has been in place since the pandemic and has really enabled us to expand our reach pretty substantially. So we, after an initial phone call or email, we can set up a time to do a virtual assessment. We can either do that through Zoom or FaceTime, or we can just have you all send questions in and then provide some feedback over the phone. And then finally, the third arm of this is in-person deployments. These are a little more complicated because they are funding dependent, but historically we've deployed after large-scale disasters such as Superstorm Sandy, Hurricanes Irma, Maria, and Harvey. But most recently, we had a series of deployments to Eastern Kentucky. And Adam and I thought that it would be helpful to kind of put our groups in context with a case study, since both FAIC and APT worked together on the third deployment to Eastern Kentucky. So I'm going to kind of set up how the deployments came to be, and then Adam is going to come back on and describe his experience deploying in person, since he was one of the people on site. So here's a timeline of just the whole process of our deployments to Kentucky. In short, in late July, from July 25th to the 30th, there was deadly thousand-year flooding in eastern Kentucky. On July 30th, we received several calls to the NHR hotline from impacted institutions in the area, one of which took us up on our offer to do a virtual assessment. We had just finalized our virtual assessment model earlier that year in 2022, so we were excited to kind of see how it went. Over the next few days, and after we understood the extent of damage and had concrete requests from institutions on the ground that wanted in-person volunteer support, we submitted a request for an NEH chair grant on August 10th to support a series of in-person deployments. Between when we submitted our request for funding to when we were notified that we would be able to facilitate these deployments, which was about a 2-month period. We stayed involved in the region by shipping PPE, personal protective equipment, to institutions in the area. We also, both Rebecca Elder, who's our NHR coordinator, and I attended coordination calls with the Kentucky Arts Council and other groups that were kind of just trying to gauge the extent of damage in the region. And then ultimately, we sent our first group of volunteers to Apple Shop, which I'll describe them a little more in detail in a bit. But our first team went from November 7th to the 11th. And then in March 2023, we facilitated 2 more deployments, the first of which entailed more work at Apple Shop, and the second of which was to Hindman, Kentucky, where we worked with Hindman Settlement School and the Appalachian School of Lutheran, which is the one that Adam was involved in. So our first 2 deployments were to Whitesburg, Kentucky. Just to give you all some context, Whitesburg is located 5 miles west of the border of Kentucky and Virginia, and is a small town with a population of just over 2,000 people. And then Apple Shop is a nonprofit located in Whitesburg that's aimed at helping people tell stories and educate others about Appalachia. Here's some photos from our first deployment there. This team helped Apple Shop recover some damaged audio tape reels. So I think they were able to clean about 500 reels over the course of the week. But also a key component of this deployment was training staff to be able to continue the work after our team left. Here are photos from the second deployment, also with Apple Shop. This team worked on book and paper materials rather than audiovisual materials. And they were able to kind of make a desiccant chamber to expedite drying throughout the, 3 or 4 days that they were on site. This is an IR picture, and it depicts one shelf in the picture on the right with damper areas in the lower parts, the vertical folder contents. Blue indicates the dampest areas, progressing from green to yellow to orange to red, being the driest. And then here's a picture of just an example of one of the damaged photographs, which you can see ran because of water contact. So then Hindman, Kentucky was our second location, third deployment, second location. And Hindman is another small town in eastern Kentucky. Its population is less than 800 people. And located in Hindman is Hindman Settlement School, which was established in 1902 and was the first rural settlement school in America. So this was really the focus of the third deployment, but at this point I'm going to pass it back to Adam because he can give much more detail about his experience on site. Let's see here.
All right, thank you, Elena. So starting off, I thought I would just share 2 observations that I had during your discussion. First, we did make a trip over to Apple Shop to look at their building and spoke with the owners. And after deploying 9 to 10 months post the flood event, a lot of the damage building materials have been removed from the building, and they're now in the process of figuring out what to do next, which is a really interesting stage to try to discuss and try to work with folks on. And the other aspect that I wanted to share is really partnering with NHR is fantastic. They have great experience with helping with collections and managing the communication with different sites to get resources deployed. Where we can fit into that is looking at the building that housed those collections. And so when I went to Kentucky, our primary focus was on the Hindman Settlement School, which is a sprawling campus throughout most of downtown Hindman, Kentucky. And we looked at, I think, 6 buildings that were damaged by flooding. And just to save time, I'm going to talk about 3 of them for context and give you a sense of what it is that we look for as architects and engineers. Okay, it'd help if I click on the presentation. There we go. So this is Main Street in Hyman, Kentucky. The Settlement School actually owns the Quilt Makers Inn, which is that center building. It's about three stories tall. And it's sandwiched on either side by the Mountain Dulcimer Museum, which is a really beautiful instrument that's true Appalachia. And they actually replicate and rebuild dulcimers at this museum. Now, this area of downtown had flooding that ranged to around 6 to 9 feet above the floor elevation. And that level of water causes significant damage. Now, as you can see, you wouldn't expect a lot of these windows to still be there after a flood. And in fact, most of them were gone. These have all been repaired within that 10-month period, which is remarkable. Now, that building, as you can see, is located towards the western side of Hyman on Main Street. Next, we're going to talk about Uncle Sol's Cabin, which is a beautiful log cabin right at the heart of the Hyman School campus. It has a special place for the school attendees, and this structure was also flooded. When we went there, most of our observations were focused primarily on just long-term maintenance issues of the building. The timbers themselves fared extremely well in the flood. And so we discussed options with the owner of possibly raising the cabin for at least to get the wood out of grade, and then also to protect it from future flood hazards. And we also looked at how they're using the building and had a short conversation about better uses of it. For example, you don't want to insulate an attic of a building that is designed to breathe. So you actually want air circulation through it so you don't promote mold growth. Now, the other building we looked at isn't historic, which is fine, but it did house the collections. So it was a very important building on the campus, and it's important to the campus functioning. They have a lot of community events within the space, and having this building flooded and offline was a real tragedy. Now, in this photo, you can see Troublesome Creek. That was the creek that flooded. And the Mullins Center is near the back of the photo. If you look carefully, you can actually see that on the side of the building we're looking at is two stories with the entrance through the lower grade. On the opposite side, the entrance is on the upper floor, and only the lower floor was flooded at this time of the flood. That said, if you look over on the left, looking at the floodplain image, you can see the outline of the flooding as it encompasses the entire building. One of the interesting things, if I may go back, this is a nerdy thing, but the FEMA review and the hazard study actually didn't provide a flood elevation for this area. It just has a flood zone A, as in it will flood in a 100-year flood. But whenever you go back and you try to design the building to withstand those floods, not having an elevation becomes extremely difficult. So talking with the tenants, we learned that their collections were housed in the basement in a state-of-the-art collection facility that has now been turned into a washer and dryer for the local community. But before then, this area within the building had temperature and humidity-controlled archives, and all of the collections in there were severely damaged. And while we're on site, the NHR team also participated with volunteers to help dry a lot of their documents and treat them in a way that they can be salvaged. The Mullins Center flooding, the flood elevations got up to about 5 feet above the ground level, And one of the key takeaways we've learned is the sooner we can get there to discuss and advise and have communication with the owners of the building, the better, because there's a lot of a strong desire to reconstruct immediately after these events. Sometimes it's worthwhile to take a step back and say, okay, if we're rebuilding, what adjustments do we want to make to the structure so that we can better weather future events and allow us to recover more quickly? You know, whether it's wet flood proofing, whether it's improving the structural performance, the high wind events, things of that nature. So that really transitions to lessons learned. And the first lesson learned is historic fabric can be saved given time and resources. So if you get there quickly, dry out the fabric, you can save a lot of historic fabric. And it's important to get there quickly because a lot of cleanup crews will remove historic fabric, anything that was touched by floodwaters, because of their concern with contamination. You really have to advocate for your building and advocate for your finishes so that you don't lose anything that could be salvaged. And then you want to reconstruct thoughtfully to improve resilience. And just as a personal lesson, consider stages of recovery prior to deployment. So we got there late, so we weren't really there to triage and help kind of create a hierarchy and needs for the owner, but we were there to kind of advise on our experience with recovery and with improving building performance for future projects. So that was my deployment to Kentucky. And now I will stop share and we'll move on to the next presentation. Thank you.
All right, it's me again. I'm gonna share my screen again. Let's see. Oh, let me see here. I need to switch my view. Okay. I think we're good. Okay, so I'm gonna give a brief overview of AFR and then I'm gonna hand it over to Stacy Bowe to describe all things Smithsonian Cultural Rescue Initiative and their HEART program. Sorry, so many acronyms, but as Robin said, we have a list of resources for you all if you want to see what we're talking about. But okay, Alliance for Response. This is an initiative that is administered through FAIC. And really the goal for AFR is to bring together cultural stewards and emergency managers at the local level. So let's see. Here are the three goals. AFR was born in 2003 and we've held events in cities and regions nationwide in over 30 places at this point. Each group has their own priorities and projects to engage members and people in their region. Some have developed mutual aid agreements with local emergency management offices. Some have worked to include an annex on cultural resources in local response plans, and some have conducted team trainings. Here are the AFR network locations currently. So all of the red dots represent active networks in the US. The two blue stars are the two newest networks. So in 2022, we kicked off networks in Chicago and in Charleston. And in the next 2 years, we will start networks in Arizona and in New Hampshire. So FAIC's role in AFR is really, there are two parts. We help networks get started, and then we help sustain and keep networks engaged. So for the getting started part, typically how this process goes is somebody from a region that does not currently have an AFR network will reach out and express interest in starting a network. We then encourage them to get in touch with neighboring institutions, maybe somebody from their local emergency management office, just people that they think would be important to participate in the steering committee, which is really the core group of people that keep the network going for at least the first few years. Typically, this group will meet for about a year, and the network will kick off at what we call a kickoff forum, which is a one-day event that we support at FAIC, where it's intentionally a mix of networking and presentations. Typically, a lot of local professionals will present on different collections emergencies that they have experienced and ways that they envision the network working together. At that point, the network has started and they kind of figure out, you know, what hazards are inherent to their region, what sort of projects and programs would benefit their members. And then comes the second part of our involvement, which is the sustainability component. So we provide, I'm gonna progress to the next screen here. We provide several different resources. First, this is a webpage where all the different AFR networks that are currently active are listed. Each network has their own page, and on the page, you can see who the leadership is, activities that they've completed, upcoming announcements, stuff of that sort. If you are curious about what the closest AFR network to you is, I would recommend starting by going to this page and seeing where a network might be closest to you, and then contacting the chair of that network or the network's email and seeing how you might get in touch with them or get involved. Next, we provide an online community for all AFR affiliates. So we have a general community for everybody associated with AFR, so any member of any network, where we, FAIC, will post announcements that are relevant to anybody. Sometimes different networks will post webinar announcements or other activities that are open outside of their network for people to participate. And this is also where we post recordings from quarterly meetings that we host for all networks. So every 3 months we have a meeting where each network is invited to send one or two people. It can be the chairs or other people that are interested. And we pick one topic per meeting to kind of take a deep dive on. So for example, our last meeting, we talked about cultural asset mapping. In our next meeting, we're gonna talk about bylaws. So just a way for everybody to exchange information and get in touch with one another. And then finally, we provide webinars. So we do about 2 webinars a year that are specific to the AFR audience. In the past few years, we've highlighted insurance considerations after disasters, health and safety considerations, implementing the incident command system at the institutional level, and establishing and maintaining supply caches. So things that are going to benefit the AFR network community. Lastly, we do recently, as of 2021, we've been providing small grants to networks to help complete different activities. This has been super successful and it's been helpful for us to be able to get money into networks to be able to, you know, do something in a very easy, seamless way. So we hope to keep that going as well. But if anybody is interested in AFR or, you know, would like to get connected to a network near them or is interested in starting one, feel free to reach out and I'll put my email in the chat here. I'm going to pass it over to Stacy because I know we're running a little short on time.
Thank you. But yes, as many of the panelists know, I can talk fast. All right, here we go. I'm the last presenter for you guys on this cavalcade of resources that we're throwing at you. Okay. And okay. And if I can get a thumbs up from, are you seeing what I want you to see? All right, thank you. Okay, so hi everybody. As it's been said, I'm Stacy. I'm thrilled to share with you some information about the program that my team specifically oversees, which is called, as you see on the screen, Heritage Emergency and Response Training, affectionately known as HEART. But before I dive into it, I thought it might be helpful to kind of take a step back and pivot the focus of the webinar to a different side of training. And that is really, how do you guys like to build your skills? Because so far, You've heard about a lot of programs who train individuals that are available to help you and possibly deploy to you in the aftermath of a disaster. But what if you're interested in enhancing your own capacity so you can do your job better at your own institution? Because, you know, maybe not all emergencies or disasters that happen at your organization, you know, require outside help. Maybe you want to just get your own team better prepared. So, because again, I'm assuming a majority of you today are joining because you're responsible for protecting heritage collections and not just in an emergency, but all the time. And you just, you want to improve processes and plans if something were to happen. And I hope what I share with you can kind of put you in the right direction on doing that. Because one of the missions of the HEART program is to, you know, help those who are doing the job already. But I also would like to say that we are not the only game in town. And really, in the past couple of years, there's been some wonderful development from many organizations, you know, within the HENTEF network and others who are creating content around this topic. And it really depends on how you want to access and learn it. So this is just really the world according to me, sharing with you. And I've kind of organized things into three different categories. And one of them is good old-fashioned self-study. You know, we're an academic field, right? So we love a textbook. So I've just thrown up here, and there are also links to all of these are also in that resources page that Robin has shared with you, not only in the chat, but I saw that it's even posted on the title page for this webinar. All of these, especially the second, third, and fourth books that are listed on there are available for free download in PDF form. And then the FEMA online catalog really is the foundational. If you want to get a better understanding of how kind of emergency management works, because you'll probably be interacting with emergency managers because of XYZ disaster, it's a really great place to start kind of learning the lingo and organizing their processes and stuff. And then the other three up there are, again, these are not the only textbooks out there. They're just three that I know I rely on for a while, which is the Be Prepared Guide, and then the First Aid for Cultural Heritage Handbook and Toolkit, and then the Getty Building an Emergency Plan. That guy's been around for a long time. So if you want to curl up with a book, I recommend those. The next is what I kind of consider like a visual verbal blended group, which is really a product of this Zoom renaissance that we live in right now. So many organizations are starting to put out and produce kind of tutorial, remote, virtual learning opportunities. And so that's another way for you guys to kind of get better understanding. So again, just a sampling that I've thrown up here. So the Association for Registrars and Collection Specialists, which is ARCS, the first bullet up here, they've been running a virtual webinar series about kind of the foundations of emergency preparedness and response for a couple of years now. I'm a teacher on it, hence why I'm plugging it. So if you're a member of that organization, definitely look for that. I just got told that they are unrolling it out for this year. It'll probably start in the fall, something to look into. Also calling out the AFRs, the Alliance for Responses. So Elena told you guys how you can kind of get an AFR started in your area, but if there's already one already active, you know, they decide, you know, how to best serve their community. And a lot of them have started to provide training or line up experts to do, you know, virtual webinars or just even virtual consultation. I'm actually a steering committee member for the Washington, D.C. Alliance for Response. And we've actually done just that, you know, having an open show and tell about disaster preparedness for local D.C. institutions. Up to you. Next one is DPLAN/ArtsReady. For those of you who have been around for a while, you probably remember DPLAN originally. It went through a massive transformation just last year, I believe, and it now sits on NEDC's website? Okay. Anyway, what it is that it's an online template that you kind of fill in according to your own organization. So you gather information in your organization and you follow the prompts that the plan gives to you to fill in. And if you get stuck, there's a beautiful YouTube complimentary library to kind of teach you how to go along. And then once you kind of finish the process, Dplan kind of spits out for you a, you know, kind of a starter disaster plan that you can now, you know, use in your organization and start executing some of the stuff that you've put in there. So it's another tool at your disposal. The next one is the Performing Arts Readiness Program that is done in partnership with Lyricists. I throw them up there because I know there's a diverse group of people sitting here in the audience. They really have been upping the content for performing arts organizations and doing very specialized webinars for those types of organizations, you know, how to do disaster preparedness for festivals, how do you take care of archives associated with like dance companies, all great stuff. So they just unveiled their big webinar calendar for the season, another thing to check out. And then finally, the conservation centers that are located throughout the country. And this isn't all of them, just a couple that I know that are currently offering up webinars about emergency preparedness and response, depending where you are. Definitely check out their websites. Four webinars, using too many web words. You know, they have freely available ones. You know, they also have ones that you can pay for that are a little bit more in detail. Again, up to you. And then finally, the last category is in-person experiential training. You know, that's the typical what you think of when we say cultural heritage emergency training. It's group work, it's traveling in person and working together with other people in practicing the skills that an expert has kind of walked you guys through. Now, again, you know, some of the organizations I've already mentioned do this as well. The conservation centers, go onto their websites, you know, they can, you can work with them on getting a workshop set up for you in your organization, or you can go and participate one that they're hosting in your local region, up to you. Same with the AFRs, depending on which ones you guys are best located near, they might be offering up some wet salvage workshops in the future. I have heard that some are starting to kind of get those workshops up and running, you know, as we're getting more comfortable in this post-pandemic work life. So definitely check them out, reach out to them. There are also independent training providers that you can contract directly to come to your organization and do a very customized training just for you and the team that you work with. It's something you can definitely think of and pursue. And then finally, squarely in this program or in this category is our HEART program. And now I'm just going to talk a little bit about what our program is. So I can't talk about the HEART program without talking about the partners, because that kind of it better helps convey, you know, just what our mission is with the HEART program. As I said, it is a program run through the partnership of my team, which is the Smithsonian Cultural Rescue Initiative. And as it says on the screen, we are the outreach arm of the Smithsonian that is disaster focused. We want to help our fellow colleagues in the museum and cultural heritage world, you know, get better understanding and capacity around this idea of disaster response for cultural heritage. We are not just international, we're domestic as well. So we are everywhere. And again, you know, we run a lot of training programs, but ultimately our consistent kind of goal is to instill, you know, readiness with anyone who is charged with safeguarding cultural heritage. And, you know, Lori's already talked about FEMA and HENTEF, but, you know, you can see up here with both of the partners on the screen, you know, why it makes so sense for us to unite and kind of put on a program such as HEART. And rather than babble at you on what we cover in HEART, I have a fabulous video to share with you guys today that was created filming our last year's class. And here we go.
Our exercise was essentially, the situation was there was a fire nearby. There was a gap in the smoke, so we could come in and save as many of the collections within this building as we could before the fire or some kind of situation changed.
Once they shut the building down, no one's allowed in.
We were kind of running through the incident command system, or ICS. We nominated an IC. I was the liaison officer, and we had other officers. So essentially kind of working through that, making mistakes, et cetera, and hopefully learning from them.
We tried to ask for a fire update. We're waiting on that.
I was incident commander, and so I was hoping to learn how to be a better leader in such situations, as well as learn how the incident command system works. My background is in curatorial knowledge, so I was really excited to focus a little bit more on the leadership side of my brain.
If we have to evacuate due to the impending fire, our rally point is those doors right there.
This training is unlike any of the others in my 20 years as an emergency manager that I've seen offered, that really hones in on planning and response for those types of specialty spaces.
It does open your eyes to the other side of what your knowledge is. So emergency management personnel, first responders, they get a little bit more insight into the curatorial side of things and why museum staff and cultural heritage staff do what they do. And on the flip side, curatorial personnel and museum personnel get an insight into emergency management systems, and that's not necessarily something we work with all the time.
I think often from an emergency management standpoint, we walk into this and we are so focused on life and safety, and things like protecting cultural heritage sites and artifacts can sometimes become an afterthought. And so trainings like this really force that to the forefront of an emergency manager's planning and efficiency and response and our ability to save more. These are items that once they're lost, and we cannot easily rebuild or recreate these artifacts or these sites.
Cultural artifacts are how we tell the story. It's how we maintain some kind of cultural memory at large. I read somewhere that a healthy museum and a community is one of the best indicators that the community as a whole is healthy. So if you have plans in place, if you have people that value those cultural artifacts, we'll save those cultural artifacts, and that preserves the community, even if that community is no longer at that location. That's why I think the artifacts are tied to the community and vice versa, and kind of saving those is how we protect all of those things.
Okay, I know we're running out of time. Okay, so yes, so I hope that gives you guys a little bit of a understanding of kind of what we accomplish in the week that HEART is. Like the video says, we really strive, again, another reason why we love the partnership with FEMA, is that we really strive to bring emergency managers and cultural heritage professionals into the room to train together. I'm happy to announce that we are moving ahead with HEART 2023. The dates are up there on the screen. It's like right in the sweet spot between Thanksgiving and Christmas. It is a competitive training program because we do have travel support and accommodation for our accepted participants. So the application for HEART, we're hoping we'll get up and running by late August, beginning of September. And feel free to email me if you have any questions. Okay, and I shall stop.
That was perfect, Stacy. Thank you so much. And thank you to all of our presenters today. We were really hoping with this May Day programming that we would talk, you know, again, a little bit about that immediate need. Then maybe when you're dealing with a disaster, especially emergency, when they're federally declared, like what Lori was explaining with the PENTIF and the FEMA resources. Also some resources that you can experience maybe a few days, a little bit out from the disaster, which is what the NHR and the APT DRI are looking at. And then when the emergency bug bites you, which it will, as someone who came from Florida and has gone through some of these trainings, where maybe you as a professional in our field can find trainings. So we were kind of trying to hit all of those aspects when it came to talking about today. I did want to hit a couple of the questions, but before I totally go, because we can sit, can you all stick around for like maybe 5 minutes for some Q&A? Okay, cool. Excellent. Real quick though, I did put in the chat the link to the May Day prize drawing. Please do that. You can win a, have, do a C2C care course in the fall. That's always fun. There's also links to resources. Stacy included a really nice little decoder ring type acronym type thing within her presentation with all of these acronyms that we've been throwing around. So thank you for doing that. And the survey for C2C care, which we always appreciate you guys filling out the surveys for us. So one question that popped in that I did want to hit is all of these organizations utilizing the incident command system for disaster response plan? Is that what most institutions are moving forwards? Do any of them provide examples of such plans that have successfully implemented ICS in their plans? So I was hoping we could talk a little bit about that, because ICS is something that comes up a lot with emergency plans. Who would like to take that on as kind of a first hit? I like Adam's movement of being on the nose. Stacy, your video mentioned ICS, man.
I know. I think let's unpack this. So for those of you happy to do acronym definite, so ICS, Incident Command System. So remember how I said, you know, the FEMA online catalog. So ICS is a bedrock process within the emergency management sphere. From what I've been told, it's how firefighters organize themselves. It's how most emergency managers come into a site, organize themselves. So just generally, it's good if you guys learn that. You don't have to apply it, but like, it's a way to build a bridge with the emergency management. And we do teach ICS in our trainings because we do think it's transferable. And it's also kind of not reinventing the wheel, you know, that way, if you do have firefighters coming to your institution, if you guys are already savvy in how each other work, your ability to work together is just going to be that much more successful. Now, this is completely my professional opinion. The museum world has a long way to go as far as implementing ICS for their disaster plans. And when you say most museums, makes me my cynical chuckle, because I don't think so. But I am a convert that if you have the opportunity, I think it's worth looking into.
So yeah, exactly what you said is sometimes you have to even learn the language to kind of understand it. And I think I saw someone else unmute their mic for a second, but I could be making that up.
Yeah, I was going to say it's something that we encourage greatly for especially Alliance for Response, because it's like in getting the two sectors to communicate, it's a really easy way to share language. For National Heritage Responders, we have everybody take the Incident Command System 100 course through FEMA. And when we do in-person deployments, we do operate through the ICS kind of structure. But I'll also just point out, there's a book by David Carmichael called Implementing the Incident. Oh,
there it is. Perfect, Robin.
my camera went off for a brief moment because I was like, let me grab my copy. The book. There's the book.
Yes. It's really helpful. At my last institution, we used the book to kind of transition our structure, and it helped dramatically. So if you are interested in, you know, learning more about ICS and making the structural change within your site, it can be a great tool.
And honestly, say with this book, like it was out of print for a little bit. Now it's back in print. It's Implementing the Incident Command System at the Institutional Level by David Carmichael. Yes, I put that in. We'll put a link to it too on the website. It helped me when I first learned about it a little 15 years ago. It helped me really relook at just how we structure any kind of organization like that, because they really play by that 5-7 rule and how you need to have like that answering hierarchy and all that. So it even kind of rewired my brain a little bit in that way, which was kind of nice. So so I would encourage that book for sure.
It really also helps, from what I've seen just working with our HEART graduates, if you are a little cultural heritage organization within a bigger system. And I'm just going to use an example, like if you're a university museum in a university, like you take direction, you probably have a security and emergency directive over you that, you know, and a way for you to get included in their plans is if you can speak ICS. It doesn't mean that you suddenly have to learn this grandiose skill set, but it's an entry point, and you will make so many friends in the emergency management world if you can come to the table going, I want to get into your system. I see that you use ICS. How can we get in there with you?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And again, we'll find the link for that, because like I said, it was out of print for a little bit, but then now it's back in print. So it's pretty exciting. One question I wanted to hit before we went is someone was asking specifically in the Q&A about how do folks work with smaller county museums? And this particular example was about a roof falling in. And everyone gave really great answers in the chat, but I did want to talk about it a little bit. So Lori, you did a good answer. Would you mind kind of synopsizing your answer you gave on that one? Oop, you're muted.
So the question was whether there was assistance offered by those of us here to help a small county museum that had a roof collapse. And so depending on whether it's a federal disaster or not, there could have been federal disaster assistance, but apparently it is not part of a major disaster declaration. So I referred her to the National Heritage Responders and provided, or him, to the National Heritage Responders hotline. And then Adam, you can contribute your part, how you responded.
Yeah, and I think that's very important to note. And there are plenty of buildings and collections that are damaged all the time, and they're not part of a national disaster FEMA rating. A pipe burst, for example, because it got cold, that's not gonna go as a disaster typically, but it is a disaster locally for the organization. And you know, we do have professionals across the country focused on preservation and archiving and all of that. So if you have something happen and you want to get in touch with someone, you don't have an engineer or an architect you've been working with regularly, reach out to us and we'll put you in contact with someone.
Thank you both for doing it. And that's kind of the point I wanted to really push is that, you know, obviously if you're in a federally recognized disaster, FEMA is there to help us, right? The group folks from HNTF are there to help us. But if some of these smaller scale disasters happen, which can happen all the time, there's other people out there to help you as well. And that's what NHR and the APT DRI folks are there for. So, you know, there's always someone there to help. And those of us who deal with emergency planning and a disaster response, we like to help. That's why we got into it. So yes, Adam.
Yeah, and I just want to say this, I think also answers Jenny's question about local disaster. And lastly, I can't go without commenting that yes, John Dumsick was in that photo for APP, and he was a founding member of the DRI. So yeah, he's still heavily involved with us.
Excellent. Thanks, Adam. All right, so we're a little over, so I'm going to go ahead and close out today's program. Again, thank you to all of our presenters. Thank you for sharing all these fabulous resources and just where you can get help and also get maybe future training if you're interested in it. I'll put in the chat one more time, link to the May Day raffle, link to our survey for this program, and then a link to all the resources that all these folks put together as well, which is greatly helpful. So thank you again. Everyone have a safe and happy May Day, and we will see you all next month in June for our next webinar, which is all about collections management policies. So thanks again, and we'll talk to you all soon.
Thank you.